Good evening and welcome to our nightly telecast of Just the News. Now, before I begin the bulletin for this evening, I have a disclaimer to give you. If you are looking for information about the exit polls on the state elections in this bulletin, you won't find it. We felt that the information on the exit polls paled in comparison and in priority to the information we have to give you about the COVID pandemic. Also, luckily for us, I have no advertising commitments that dictate that we prioritize the exit polls over the pandemic. So this is our information for you. To begin with, India has recorded 3,79,000 new COVID cases in the last 24 hours as of information updated this morning, on Thursday morning. 3,645 lives were lost due to COVID in just one day, making it the highest figure in 24 hours we have recorded so far. Well, the case in Delhi High Court on the management of COVID in the national capital continues. The Delhi High Court today pulled up the central government for saying that Delhi has enough allocation of oxygen. Remember, the existing demand for oxygen from Delhi is 704 metric tons. Its current allocation from the central government is 490 metric tons, and it's actually receiving between 335 to 340 metric tons of oxygen. To which the bench of Justice Vipin Sanghi and Rekha Pali responded, saying, "We cannot accept that. People close to us are not getting beds or oxygen. You are aware of it. We've heard about people dying in Haryana. We've heard about people dying in Meerut because of a lack of oxygen. We've heard about it in Delhi. We're getting calls to arrange for beds and oxygen." According to a report in the Indian Express, a Solicitor General, who is the lawyer who argues for the Government of India, Mr. Tushar Mehta, argued that the matter is being politicized by the Delhi government. He said they did demand 700, but allocation is 480-490. Actual quantity coming to Delhi is 335 to 340. According to our assessment, this is sufficient, he submitted before the court. The bench questioned him on why the allocation to Delhi was not increased given the rising number of cases in the state. The Solicitor General also suggested to the court that if the court desires, oxygen can be moved from Madhya Pradesh to Delhi at the cost of people's lives in Madhya Pradesh. The bench took serious exception to this suggestion and said, "Please do not project it like that. Do not project it as if we are wanting something to be taken away. We do not appreciate it. The court has been hearing several pleas on the oxygen crisis in the national capital," end quote. The Delhi High Court also issued orders to the Aam Aadmi Party government's revenue department to release remdesivir seized by the police to the hospitals. The same bench issued direction to ensure that the seized medicine does not remain as case property and does not lose its effectiveness and can be administered to patients in need. In the meantime, the Ministry of Home Affairs of the Government of India has said that health and other responsibilities of the state of Delhi lies solely with the Kejriwal-led elected government of Delhi. The Government of National Capital Territory Amendment Act 2021 came into force yesterday after being passed by Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha and receiving the assent of the President in March. This act basically puts the powers of the state into the hands of the Lieutenant Governor, who reports to the Government of India. But the statement released by the Home Ministry on this matter said quite clearly that health, and one assumes therefore the chaos that is arising out of the health crisis in Delhi now, is entirely the responsibility of the elected state government. Moving on to information about vaccines. Now, just one day to go before the center's vaccination drive will begin for all adults in the country, 18 to 45 specifically, several states have begun to say they do not have enough vaccination stock to vaccinate the rest of the population. Counterclaims made by several states, the Health Ministry of the government on Tuesday showed data showing vaccination stock in different states. The data showed 150 million doses have been given to states so far. 10 million are still available with them. Another 8 million doses will be supplied to them by the center in the next 3 days. Data also showed that vaccine wastage was almost 5% or more in 8 of those states. In Maharashtra, it was a much lower level of 0.22%. Delhi was almost 4%. Delhi's Health Minister Satyendra Jain has said the capital does not have enough vaccines to vaccinate all adults starting the 1st of May. "We have requested companies to provide it," Jain told reporters when they asked him about it. "We will tell you in a day or two," he said. In the meantime, in Mumbai, Vaccinations of those between the ages of 18 and 44 will not start on the 1st of May in Mumbai because of a shortage of doses. So said Ashwini Bhide, the additional municipal commissioner of the BMC. She said vaccination of the new age group will start only after enough vaccines are made available and not exactly on the 1st of May. In the meantime, as states scramble to get their vaccine stocks replenished, Gujarat Chief Minister Vijay Rupani has made a statement saying the state will receive 2.5 crore vaccine doses over the next 15 days. According to ANI, the Chief Minister has said that the Gujarat government will receive 2 crore doses of Covishield vaccine from the Serum Institute of India, 50 lakh doses of Covaxin from Bharat Biotech. He requested everybody above the age of 18 to start getting vaccinated whenever they get stock in the next 15 days. At the same time, Kerala Health Minister K.K. Shalja has made a statement to ANI as well, saying, "We've been placing orders, but vaccine companies are saying that they will only supply the vaccine at the end of May or the beginning of June. This 1 month delay can be very dangerous. We need vaccines urgently to save lives. How can we start vaccinating those above the age of 18 when the second dose of the vaccine is still pending for everyone, for most people above the age of 45? We have only 3 to 4 lakh vaccine doses left," she said. This is Kerala Chief Minister, Kerala Health Minister, I beg your pardon, K.K. Shalja. A day after Serum Institute's Adar Poonawalla dropped the rate of Covishield from 400 to 300 rupees per dose for state governments, Bharat Biotech has slashed its rates for state governments to 400 rupees a dose from what was earlier 600 rupees a dose. In a statement released by the company, it said, "Recognizing the enormous challenges to the public healthcare system, we've made Covaxins available to the state governments at the price of 400 rupees a dose." Now, as we have reports coming in from across the country of long queues outside crematoriums, bodies piling up in hospitals and in crematoriums, the health minister of the government of India, Dr. Harshvardhan, has said India's fatality rate is among the lowest in the world at 1.1%. The statement comes as India has reported 3,645 fatalities in just 24 hours. He also said that people are also recovering from the infection at the same pace as they are getting infected, adding that it's important to give proper advice on diagnosis and treatment to COVID patients. I want to issue a warning to our audience. The few pieces of information are extremely distressing. In the capital of India, New Delhi, which reels under the shortage of beds and oxygen supply and space in crematoriums, reports now say civic bodies are scrambling for space in the city to provide for areas where people can cremate their dead. Preparations are now underway to turn a pet crematorium in Dwarka, which was meant for dogs, into a human cremation ground. The South Delhi Municipal Corporation, according to India Today, plans to create a human funeral pyre platforms on this site that was meant to be a dog crematorium. According to authorities, the 3-acre dog crematorium site in Dwarka, Sector 29, was constructed 6 months ago but has not become operational yet. Meanwhile, the Karnataka government has earmarked 230 acres of land around Bengaluru as cremation grounds for COVID victims, given the number of cases that are rising in the city. Cremation grounds will be set up in 23 locations in the villages in areas like Mundanapalya, Maragondanahalli, Mathisandra and Golahalli, and in talukas across Bangalore South, North, East and Anekala. This comes after reports of long queues outside crematoriums in Bangalore, with the city's case fatality going up very sharply. 137 people died due to COVID on Wednesday, according to government data, although media reports say that that number is grossly underreported. The Uttarakhand government, now reacting to the criticism it has received, has decided to suspend the Chardham Yatra for this year because of the COVID surge in the state. The Yatra was supposed to happen on the 14th of May. The Chief Minister, Tiraj Singh Rawat, said conducting a Yatra amid a raging pandemic is not possible. Only the priests of the four temples of Badrinath, Kedarnath, Yamunotri and Gangotri will perform the puja. Uttarakhand recorded its highest single-day spike of 6,054 COVID cases on Wednesday and 108 deaths. The decision to suspend the Chardham Yatra also comes after the Uttarakhand High Court really took the state government to task for organizing the Kumbh Mela. The High Court said holding the Kumbh Mela in the state has made the state of Uttarakhand a laughing stock. The judges also questioned the decision of holding the Chardham Yatra at a time when COVID cases were sharply rising in the state. Karnataka's Revenue Minister R. Ashoka on Wednesday said many infected people in the city of Bengaluru have switched off their phones and are not traceable. 3,000 of them have gone missing, he said. The minister has asked the police to trace these people. He said, and I quote, "I pray to them with folded hands that the COVID cases will only increase due to this behavior. It is wrong of them to do this and then reach for ICU beds at the absolute last moment." The Karnataka government has closed down the state for 2 weeks with strict restrictions after the city of Bengaluru ran out of beds because of the massive surge of COVID. In the meantime, hashtag calling for the resignation of Prime Minister Narendra Modi because of the mishandling of the COVID situation was blocked on Facebook for several hours on Wednesday. Over 12,000 posts critical of the government, the ruling government in the centre, were allegedly censored by the social media platform, according to a report by Quint. Anyone looking for these posts yesterday, the hashtag was called Resign Modi in India, were shown a notice by Facebook saying the posts have been temporarily hidden because there's comments in these posts which were considered against the website's community standards. The move received a lot of criticism. Facebook later restored those posts. According to the Indian Express, a company spokesperson said, "We temporarily blocked the hashtag by mistake and not because the Indian government asked us to. It has since been restored." The Ministry of Information Technology on Thursday responded to this in a statement saying a Wall Street Journal story attributing the removal of a certain hashtag on Facebook to the government of India's efforts to curb political dissent. "This is misleading on facts and mischievous in intent. The government hasn't issued any directions to remove the hashtag. Facebook has clarified that it was removed by mistake." A quick look at the new restrictions announced by various state governments. Uttar Pradesh government has decided that weekend lockdowns in the state will now include Mondays and will conclude on Tuesday mornings at 7 a.m. Remember, the state, which is reporting rising cases and pressure on its healthcare system, has not called for a complete lockdown yet. Madhya Pradesh government has extended its corona curfew until the 7th of May. Madhya Pradesh has been reporting about 12,000 cases every day. Former Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh on Thursday was discharged from AIIMS Trauma Centre after recovering completely from COVID-19. The 88-year-old was admitted to AIIMS on the 19th of April after testing positive for COVID. In other news, the family members of the people who were killed in Thoothukudi in the firing of the police back in 2018 observed a Black Thursday to protest the state government's decision to open the plant. 13 people died in when the anti-Sterlite protests were fired upon by the police in 2018. Holding photographs of the deceased, the protesters raised slogans outside the collector's office against the decision of the Supreme Court allowing the operation of the plant for oxygen production. Remember, Vedanta, who owns that plant, the company, approached Supreme Court and asked for an emergency hearing. The company said it could produce 1,000 tons of oxygen and can supply it to states free of cost. Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, Palaniswamy, had convened an urgent meeting where he decided that the plant will be reopened with restrictions. A Madras High Court judge, in news outside of COVID, has said he will undergo counselling himself in order to understand same-sex couples better before passing a judgment in a case where same-sex couples have asked for protection from the court from threats from their parents. While passing an interim order, the judge has said he will take more time to churn since the counsel, Muniraj, had asked that the court set guidelines for all future cases of this nature. He said, and I quote, "Ultimately, in this case, the words must come from my heart and not from my head. And at the same time, it will not be possible if I'm not fully woke on this aspect." He has requested a psychologist to fix a convenient appointment with him for a session that will help him evolve and understand more. Taking a look now at news coming in from across the world. The United States is planning to send supplies worth more than $100 million to India to face the devastating second wave of COVID infections. Supplies will include oxygen generation systems and raw materials for vaccines. The first emergency relief shipment, which will include 440 oxygen cylinders and regulators donated by the state of California, about 9.5 lakh rapid diagnostic tests, and 100,000 N95 masks provided by USAID. The first shipment is expected to arrive on a military transport aircraft soon, along with packages from Russia and the European Union. Turkey is all set to enforce a nationwide lockdown starting today until the 17th of May because of the third wave of COVID in the country. Turkish president has said the country will go into full closure and requires people without valid reason to stay indoors and all non-essential businesses to be shut. Quick look at news coming in from the world of science and technology. Apollo 11 astronaut Michael Collins, who piloted the command module in the 1969 Apollo mission to the moon, has died at the age of 90 due to cancer, his family said in a statement. Often described as the forgotten astronaut, Collins stayed on board the command module when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin became the first humans to walk on the moon. News coming in from the world of sports right now. After five cricketers pulled out of the IPL 2021, two umpires have also quit the tournament. This included Indian umpire Nitin Menon and Australian umpire Paul Rifle. Nitin Menon flew home to Indore after his mother and his wife tested positive for COVID, whereas Australian umpire Paul Rifle pulled out due to anxiety that the Australian government is not allowing flights from India back into Australia. In the meantime, the IPL 2021 continues. Competitors of the Tokyo Olympics will have to undergo daily COVID tests at the Summer Olympics and the Paralympics. They will need to wear face masks at all times, except when they're eating, drinking, sleeping, training, or competing. Those traveling from outside Japan will be given a phone with apps for health reporting and contact tracing, and there will be no international fans at the Games. The Olympics are due to begin on the 23rd of July. Leaving you with one piece of good news, two class 10 students in Bengaluru have managed to raise 2 lakh rupees to buy oximeters for the underprivileged. Sneha Raghavan and Shloka Ashok will be donating 300 pulse oximeters with the money that they have raised. The oximeters will be distributed to slum dwellers in Bengaluru and rural women in Koppal in North Karnataka. I'm going to leave you there. Remember to stay safe. Leave us a comment on how we can improve this bulletin for you. And thanks for watching. Good night.